let me please to, we are, our numbers are increasing, but it looks that it has stabilized at 60 as I see now. So may I introduce our first speaker, Dr. Philip Scheltens, a professor of cognitive neurology. And he's also the director of the Alzheimer Center at the Free University Medical Center in Amsterdam. In 2011, Dr. Scheltens was appointed scientific director at the Perelstring Institute and elected a member of the Royal Netherlands Academy of Arts and Sciences, where he is now a member of the board. He is an honorary professor of neurology at University College London. And his main clinical and research interests are Alzheimer's disease, vascular dementia, frontotemporal dementia, magnetic resonance imaging, PET imaging, and biomarkers for disease detection and early diagnosis. He is active in the field of biomarkers and clinical trials and has been the national primary investigator for many trials, including phase 1-3 international multicenter clinical trials. So, Philip, we are very pleased to have you again with us. It is our pleasure. Welcome, and the floor is yours.
Many thanks, Eva, and many thanks, Alzheimer Europe, for hosting this session and inviting me and all the others to speak. It's a great pleasure. It's a great times for Alzheimer's disease, exciting times, I would say. And the present where we are now had not been possible without the development of biomarkers. So I think it's good to just reflect on the history of the diagnostic paradigm for Alzheimer's disease, because it will ultimately also lead easily into the next talk, which is more about the treatment, both sort of the medical treatment and also the lifestyle treatment. So can I have the next slide? These are my disclosures, and I think you have recognized and you also heard in the introduction that I have been working with a lot of different companies and organizations over the years, and they are listed there. And particularly, I'm also clinical trial PI, some of the international studies, for instance, with Vivorion and also the vaccine of UCB and AC Immune. Next. So, when it all started in 1906, there was no clinical diagnosis. Basically, there was a description of signs and symptoms, and the ultimate diagnosis was made post-mortem. Alzheimer himself had never diagnosed Alzheimer's disease because it didn't exist at that time. And it was later on that the characteristics, plaques and tangles, were actually made into what we now know as Alzheimer's disease from a pathological standpoint. Then, but also still now, and I think we have added neuronal death and also synaptic dysfunction to the main characteristic sort of features of Alzheimer's disease. But the two main characteristics were already known in 1906, but no clinical diagnosis at that time. Next, in 1984, actually, interestingly, the year when I graduated from medical school, it was a working group in the United States that tried to formulate clinical criteria for Alzheimer's disease from a neurological perspective. I will not talk about a DSM at the moment. At that time, memory impairment was already recognized as an important feature, plus one other cognitive impairment, language or praxis or executive function. It had to be a decline from a previous level, of course, with impact on daily living, progressive, and not due to any other disorder. So that is basically a concept of exclusion. So if you cannot find another explanation for the signs and symptoms that are listed here, then it's just probably Alzheimer's disease. And that is actually the definition and the criteria, the diagnostic criteria we worked for a long time. And the present drugs that we still have now, the cholinesterase inhibitors, were tested in a population that actually had this as a clinical criterion and a diagnostic framework at that time. So no biomarkers at that time at all, except from a CT scan to rule out the brain tumor. Next. And a long time actually evolved. And in the meantime, between 84 and 2007, a lot of things happened, but I will not go into that because that will take another hour. But the main development was actually in the biomarkers. So the CSF biomarkers were developed, the MRI biomarkers were developed, even PET scan, amyloid PET scan was developed in 2004. And that made a lot of researchers, among which the International Working Group led by Bruno Dubois and myself at that time, to rethink the biological definition and the clinical biological concept of Alzheimer's disease. So to add to the episodic memory impairment and other cognitive impairment, at that time, we added the biomarkers that we knew at that time were very sensitive and specific for Alzheimer's disease, such as medial temporal lobe atrophy, abnormal CSF biomarkers, or at that time, even FDG PET or amyloid PET, as a sort of support for the clinical diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. So we could then diagnose Alzheimer's disease based on one single cognitive domain, for instance, memory, plus evidence from the biomarkers that amyloid and or tau were present. Next. It took some time. This is 2010, in which the challenge was not to only to recognize the phenotype as a memory problem, but also recognizing that there were other phenotypes under the umbrella of Alzheimer's disease. For instance, the atypical forms, so the language variant or the posterior cortical variant. And we incorporated this in the network, in the framework in 2010. And we said, well, it doesn't really matter what kind of phenotype there is, as long as the biomarkers are present, you can call this Alzheimer's disease. And we also recognize that there is mixed disease. But of course, as we know, there are no operational definitions for mixed disease. So that was a little bit sort of hanging in there in between. We also recognized at that time preclinical AD, so asymptomatic, at risk for Alzheimer's disease at that time. That meant that if you don't have any signs or symptoms, but you do have the biomarkers, we at that time already sort of designated that as having a risk for Alzheimer's disease. Next. And this was followed up by 2014. We had to refine the framework because we at that time identified that MRI was actually not that specific for the disease. And we also recognized that CSF and amyloid tau were actually much more important to define the underlying pathology, A-beta and tau to be specific. And also again, with the clinical phenotypes as listed here. The preclinical states were also acknowledged at that time, but as you can see here, the word at risk is always kept in the formulation. Next. In 2016, a large working group members of the International Working Group were also present, defined the ATN grouping. And the ATN stands for amyloid, tau, and neurodegeneration as a sort of unbiased descriptor classification scheme for Alzheimer's disease biomarkers. And in the next slide, it is shown which they are. Here they are listed. So the A stands for amyloid, which you can show by CSF A-beta 42 or the ratio 40-40, or nowadays also in plasma. Plasma ratio 40-42 is really very sort of specific at the time, and it's possible to do this, not on an individual level, but on group level, and in trials it's already been done. Amyloid PET, of course, is a sign of A, and for the T, for specific phosphorylated tau as the pathology in Alzheimer's disease, CSF phosphorylated tau 181, or plasma P tau 181, or 217, or even 234. And tau PET, of course, which is the new kid on the block that was introduced in 2016. For the N, for the neurodegeneration, there are a lot of biomarkers present, for instance, structural MRI, FDG PET, also total tau in CSF or in plasma, and also neurofilament light. So by using this biomarker grouping, the A, the T, and the N, you can actually define the underlying pathology in a brain of a specific patient. And that was then the next step that was turned into a framework. Next slide, please. Into a framework. And that is here on the left. And that's in 2018. And that was presented as a framework for research incorporating the amyloid and tau and neurodegenerative biomarkers into a scheme using to define the biology of Alzheimer's disease in vivo. So if you have A plus and T plus, and regardless whether there is neurodegeneration or not, we call this Alzheimer's disease. And notably, this is a framework that actually defines Alzheimer's disease by its biological features. So not anymore by clinical features. And this is actually a big step forward in the sense that regardless of the phenotype, even if you don't have symptoms, you can diagnose Alzheimer's disease by looking at these biomarkers. If you have only amyloid and no tau, then we call this Alzheimer's pathophysiology or on the way to Alzheimer's disease. And together they form the Alzheimer's pathophysiological continuum, recognizing that Alzheimer's disease is a continuum, that it starts with no abnormalities, probably starts with deposits of A-beta first and then followed by tau and neurodegeneration. That's still something that is debated and a lot of work is going into that. And there are probably exceptions as well. But I think the most important part is actually on the right side here. And we summarized this in the recent seminar in Lancet, that the use of biomarkers and the use of the ATN criteria operationalized Alzheimer's disease as a continuum, starting in normal individuals, ultimately leading to dementia. Disentangling dementia from Alzheimer's disease, because dementia is now a stage and not anymore equal to Alzheimer's disease by definition. Of course, clinical staging remains important for research and for clinical trials. So we have also in the right lower corner, we have sort of used the ATN criterion and together link them also with the sort of old-fashioned criteria like cognitively impaired MCI and dementia, terms that you can still use, but it's actually less relevant because you define the disease by the biology. Again, this is a research framework, and I think it helped research a lot. And a lot of the studies that are now ongoing, a lot of the trials that are ongoing, are actually using this definition to define the patients. Next. After that, a lot of controversy came out in the literature, which is always interesting, of course, especially people looking to point at the fact that vascular dysfunction was not recognized. And we know that vascular dysfunction is important, especially in later onset patients or elderly patients. People supported the framework and others didn't support the framework. Next. And this is also the response to, and I think many of the confusion was that still people sort of equate Alzheimer's disease with a dementia syndrome or a clinical syndrome, which now that was the whole issue of the NIA framework, is to disentangle those two, to have a biological definition outside of the realm of dementia or MCI or whatever clinical category you mean. That is perhaps a little bit fast forward in some people's mind, but that was a lot of the confusion that was created after that. Next. And I think what is important, that's very recently the IWG working group, at least a part of that working group, actually tried to go back a little bit in time, because they said, well, research criteria are fine using biomarkers. We do understand that this is important, but for the clinician, in any memory clinic or whatever in the world, it's perhaps a little bit too difficult. And also perhaps there are certain risks and certain ethical considerations to define people. And that's where the discussion was really all about, who have no symptoms or signs, who are asymptomatic, call them Alzheimer's disease on the basis of their biomarkers. And that's why this working group actually advised for the clinicians not to do this, and to say, well, you have risk. So you have seen in the earlier slides, I identified the risk, sort of, and this is actually going back to that category, not saying, well, you have Alzheimer's disease because you have amyloid and tau. No, you have the risk of developing Alzheimer's disease if you're asymptomatic. Well, this is, of course, up for debate, and this is what this field, it makes it so interesting to be in, because there's always debate, there's always progress, and we have to see where we come out. But I think it will all change when we have many more of the disease modifying agents at hand that we can work with, because the future ultimately will decide where we will treat the patients, where we will start treating patients very early on or only when they have clinical symptoms. Okay, enough about this. Next. I think what we also defined in 2018, I think that was actually what we put forward, and said, well, this whole framework needs testing, and we need to know whether A always is followed by T and N is followed then next step. Is that true, or are they developing at the same time, or are there other sequences? And this needs to be studied. And using the ATN framework, you can study this particularly. So next, a few examples only. I will quickly do this. This is the study by Donahue and JAMA, looking at actually a preclinical Alzheimer cognitive composite, so at a cognitive endpoint, and clearly showing that having amyloid is not good for the brain. Over a period of 10 years, a large proportion of the people who had elevated amyloid in the brain, either by CSF or PET actually, did decline on a cognitive endpoint. So making the point, and that's important because some people doubt that, making the point that having only amyloid is really sort of making your cognition worse. Next is another study by Rick Ossercoppola in our lab showing that already baseline tau levels predict concurrent cognition, so the cognition at that cross-sectional level. So worse cognition is seen in people with higher tau levels, which is important. It links very much also on a cross-sectional level, which is not the case with amyloid, but on a cross-sectional level, tau really correlates very well with cognition. And next, also, if you see at the baseline tau, it also predicts cognitive change. So people with high tau levels are actually more prone to decline faster than people who have lower tau levels. All important to realize and to know, and also to get a grip and to get insight in this sort of, the relative contributions of amyloid and tau to the ultimate clinical picture. Next. Our own study, sort of published last year by Jared Ebenau, also clearly showed that if you have normal AD biomarkers, if you have no pathology, and you have subjective cognitive decline, in 5 years' time, you will not decline. So if you have a subjective cognitive decline or complaints, you go to a memory clinic and the biomarkers are normal, you can really reassure these people. And this is a very important aspect of use of biomarkers that is often neglected. A large proportion of the people can actually be reassured because they are normal and will not decline. And if you have non-AD pathological change, so if you have only neurodegeneration or you have only a little bit high tau, it is actually the same as having completely normal biomarkers. But the only thing that is different is when you have amyloid and tau, when you're in the Alzheimer's continuum, you really will decline over time. And this is a real life memory clinic observation with people with subjective cognitive decline. Next. Well, of course, the framework was meant to be used in clinical trials. And after 2018, some of the trials were already ongoing. But here's a nice example of the donanemab study, also published in the New England Journal very recently, where all patients were selected on the basis of presence of amyloid on PET and presence of tau, but not too much. They were actually sort of calibrated on the level of tau to be included. And this is how it should be done. And this is how we can actually prevent failures in the future to select patients on the proper biomarkers, because we only want patients who have the pathology in the brain. Otherwise, it's no use treating them. In this particular phase two study, there was a significant difference in the combined cognitive functional endpoint using this particular monoclonal antibody. And also, as we have seen with aducanumab, and as you see with all the monoclonal antibodies, they're extremely powerful in reducing the amount of amyloid on your PET scan. They do really target the amyloid and they work. Next. What we have seen using these criteria is actually that many more trials actually involve now pre-dementia patients. So only almost half of the trial, this is a cross-sectional observation of a year ago, actually of the ongoing trials actually involve already early patients, very early patients, pre-dementia patients. So prodromal patients or very early AD patients. And this is only possible if you use biomarkers. Next. And of course, not to dismiss the fact that a lot of people have comorbidity. And this is often overlooked, or people suggest that we overlook this, but this is not the case. But the nice thing about co-pathology is that you don't have to wait for autopsy to actually find them. We have all the instruments to define the co-pathology in a particular patient. We have MRI to show us microhemorrhages as a sign of coagulopathic angiopathy. We have hippocampal atrophy. If it's really out of the range of the general atrophy, you may think of the late syndrome because it is amyloid negative, but it has a lot of hippocampal atrophy. DLB is a condition that is now more easily recognized because we have the DOT scan, but we also can look in CSF whether the patients have co-pathology of Alzheimer's disease. And of course, general vascular comorbidity, as was mentioned earlier, we have the instruments. We can actually identify exactly the amount of vascular burden. Next. So, and it ultimately leads to better drug development. I'm very passionate about drug development. I think we should do a better job than we have done in the past. And this is together with Jeff and Howard, we wrote this the five rights of drug development for precision approach. And this is all about using the biomarkers to select the right patients, to identify target engagement, as you have seen with the monoclonal antibodies, and to select the right participants and do ultimately the right trial with the proper endpoints. And this is where all these biomarkers actually come in and where they can be helpful. And I think that's one of the big advantages that we have now as opposed to a couple of years ago. Next. Now we have to, I'm ending here. We should not forget that the image that I have of Alzheimer's disease is particularly different from the image that a spouse may have when the patient or the spouse is actually in the nursing home suffering from dementia. What we researchers now say, well, we identify the disease so early, we can actually, in the patient on the left side who is still climbing mountains, he may have a head full of amyloid. He will deteriorate over time, but perhaps we should treat him now. But of course, the lay audience and people in the field actually much more sort of focus on the image to the right. What is usually associated with Alzheimer's disease is people at the end stage of the dementia in the nursing home. And we should be mindful of that difference of perspectives that we have as researchers, while the lay audience and the patient and the caregivers out there may have a different perspective. I think next slide shows a very elegant insight. This is a patient himself who was a neurologist, Dan Gibbs. He's actually still alive. He actually participated in the aducanumab studies. And he says it very, very well. He recognized by himself that it was declining. And he said, and I have put this in yellow, we as neurologists will need to provide the leadership to promote early diagnosis of AD and the education of our patients and how to management of risk. It is possible now, due to the biomarkers, and it is certain to improve in the not too distant future. So we had already sort of envisioned that there will be a time that there will be better medication that we can treat these patients in a very early stage in order, and I say it again, in order to prevent the stage of dementia. That's what it's all about. Next. So to conclude, I think we all know since more than a century that A-beta and tau are the culprits of AD, and we can now assess them in vitro and with many, many techniques, even in blood. And early detection, as Dan Gibbs put it in the JAMA paper, is key to any therapy that you want to develop, even lifestyle interventions. I think the 2018 framework greatly enhanced the field in that sense. It helped trial design, trial execution. But we have to realize clinical practice, when somebody has a practice sort of outside of the possibility to have MRI or CSF or PET analysis, we have to also acknowledge that that still exists and we may need other approaches for that. And as scientists, as I said, we have to also be aware of the different narratives that people have when they think of dementia and Alzheimer's disease. And I'll end with a pre-COVID picture of the team, the last picture we could take and standing so close to each other. We haven't done that since then, but hopefully we can do that in the future again. Thank you very much for your attention.
Eva, the floor is yours. Eva, you are on mute. Hang on.
Okay. No.
There you go.
Don't worry. I was muted by the host, so sorry for my delay. I would like to thank you very much, Philip, for your fantastic presentation, because you have led us through historical developments and presented the current understanding and also provided the view into the future. It is in so few minutes. I really admire it. We have few, and we managed to be on time or ahead of time. So I think we can ask some questions. And I see somebody who is Jean-Georges. We know him as well. And he says, great overview of the changing definition and our increased understanding of Alzheimer's disease as a biological rather than clinical concept. When communicating about Alzheimer's, should associations like Alzheimer Europe and national associations, but also politicians use the research criteria you presented or the clinical definition? How can we avoid confusion when communicating about AD?
Yeah. Maybe just as a backdrop to the question that I was asking, Philip, this was before you presented the slides where you were trying to reconcile the kind of point of view of researchers on the one hand and a kind of lay public on the other. But for me, it's just like, how can we make sure that when we're talking about the same disease, we're actually using the same terminology and we don't create confusion sometimes?
Well, Jean, I have only two comments, and I think we cannot emphasize much that Alzheimer is a disease. So I think whenever you talk and the politicians, we recognize that it's a brain disease. It happens in the brain, it starts very early on, and you can have it when you have only minor symptoms. And the second thing I would emphasize, and that's also something for Alzheimer Europe to emphasize, is dementia is only a stage, and a really bad stage of a metastatic Alzheimer's disease in the brain that actually has gone too far, and we want to prevent that particular stage. I think if you have those two things in mind, I think that is really valuable for the communication.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the precious advice. And do we have any other questions? Not now, but our discussion is planned in the end of the meeting. You will stay with us until the end of the meeting. So thank you very much.